as yet another example of the decline of our once great nation, I offer you the contrast between wrestling at the Chase and wrestling as we now know it, filled with dark overtones, everyone's a bad guy, abuse of women, racist stuff, in contrast to the happy-go-lucky days of wrestling at the Chase, where a good guy was a good guy, a bad guy got his comeuppance, and everybody went home happy, and Mickey Garagiola, rather than Vince McMahon, presided over the activities. The contrast is plain. You decide, Mr. and Mrs. America.
Hi, everybody, and welcome once again to Wrestling at the Chase. Yes, sir.
Goes to the hanging backbreaker with an airplane spin. Look at that. A backbreaker and an airplane spin combined.
Harley Race, Dick the Bruiser, the Von Erichs, King Kong Brody, Ric Flair, Ted DiBiase, they're all here today on Wrestling at the Chase. Hello, I'm Larry Matysik, and no, this is not the Twilight Zone. Wrestling at the Chase never died. That style of wrestling with great athletes, a healthy dose of showmanship, and straightforward promotion never died. The television ratings were spectacular. The buildings were filled to capacity. And it was only yesterday, wasn't it?
O'Connor's gonna get out of it.
Pressure to Kevin Von Erich, and you can see right where that leg is, underneath the shoulder, making it even harder for Kevin Von Erich to regain his feet. So Kevin flips over, comes up, counters to a wrist lock, down goes Starr. Good move by Kevin Von Erich.
DiBiase twisting the leg, and here comes the figure four leg lock by the Missouri State champion. Starr doesn't want to submit.
Price ducks. Price waiting. Oh, Rocky goes to the hanging backbreaker with an airplane spin. Look at that. A backbreaker and an airplane spin combined. Roshke lining Brown up for the claw. The claw. Brown blocks it. Brown blocks the brain claw of Roshke. The claw being blocked by Bulldog Brown. He's Roshke straining, trying to get the claw on Brown. Look how close he is. Here comes Race on the top rope. Race on the top rope. Diving headbutt from the top rope by Harley Race.
Wherever I go in St. Louis, even today, people still ask about wrestling at the Chase. It brought the greatest professional wrestling in the country to St. Louis. It also brought together a great city, from the people in living rooms, in bowling alleys, in church basements, in hospitals. And it also brought together the wrestling world with the formation of the National Wrestling Alliance.
I approached Sam. I said, hey, I'm going out of my mind here. If he will be partners. And I said, I'll do the wrestling and you take care of the business. When he put NWA together, why, it was a creative thing, and it was a masterstroke, actually, because that's what the wrestling actually needed at that time, needed some credibility. And because a lot of these people that were wrestling promoters were had graduated from carnivals, and some of them never got out from under the tent, you know, they were still there, you know.
Dory Funk Jr., Lou Thesz, Pat O'Connor, Johnny Valentine, Dick the Bruiser, Harley Race, the list of superstars goes on and on. We know you want to see wrestling, so let's take a look at some of the great moments from Wrestling at the Chase.
The ring by Dory Jr. Oh, driver tried to kick Dory Jr. Dory stopped him, drops him with the forearm, spinning toe hold. The spinning toe hold by Dory Funk Jr. on Sonny Driver.
Debbie Combs mounting the ropes, crawling behind Kay Robertson. She's riding Kay Roberts with a victory roll. That's what it's sometimes called, a rolling front head scissors. And there's the first fall. Brody, drop kick. Whoa. Oh, by King Kong Brody, 6'5", 290.
Here comes Ron McFarland in. He grabs Wells in a wrist lock. Both men with wrist locks. Look at Wells. He's free, and he flips both. Oh!
Blackwell comes off the rope. Reed comes flying the other. Flying cross body block. Blackwell caught him. Or did he? He loses it. Reed covers him. This could be it. One, two, oh! Atlas turns Patera in the corner. The referee wants a break, but before Atlas can break, oh, the whip reversed. Atlas hit the corner, Patera. Oh, big body slam.
Again, Brown's ear is used as leverage so that Andrews can hang on to the Bulldog.
Orton going up on the second rope. I've heard about this, the super suplex. You've never seen it here. If he can take, look out below. Oh, what a suplex. What a suplex by Cowboy Bob Orton.
Still to come, interviews with the wrestlers, the referees, the announcers that made Wrestling at the Chase famous. But first, a tribute to the man who made it all possible, the incomparable promoter, Sam Muchnick.
He gave the people what he wanted and what they wanted. And he was the greatest entrepreneur I've ever met in my life.
I remember the first match in 1932 when I worked for Tom Peck, Ray Steele, and Jim McMillan. I remember Strangle Lewis and Jimmy Landis and Lou Thesz and Buddy Rogers.
This is a sad moment because Sam's been a friend and a teacher for so long, and it's going to be a very different feeling not having him here on a day-to-day basis, but we know he's there if we need him in a pinch, and that does mean something. Sam Muchnick, thank you very much. We'll be back with more right after this.
Wrestling can't exist without the promoter, and St. Louis was blessed with one of the greatest ever in Sam Muchnick, my friend, my teacher. Sam tied the whole package together and made it so unique in St. Louis. Sam Muchnick made a contribution to wrestling second to none.
I was the official physician for the wrestling matches, and I would, when the wrestlers would come in and sit down there, and when they found out who I was, they every one of them would say how it's such a pleasure to work in St. Louis with someone who had such high integrity.
He worked awful hard at his job, and he was very good at what he did. And he was the guy, he was the chair, he knew all these guys. And he knew what he had to do. People would rely on him for advice. He would give it. And Sam was, he was just a thorough professional, which is the highest accolade I can pay.
He didn't want the wrestlers to touch the announcers. You leave them alone. The ring announcers, you let them alone. Keep your hands off the referees too. And, you know, and he would always say, I'm paying you to wrestle inside the ring, not outside the ring. So you stay inside.
I can always remember Sam when he gets within the hallway or in the back room, Sam would say, now, you fellas are wrestling tonight. I don't want either one of you to touch any of these referees. I want my referees protected. And we were protected because Sam backed us all the way.
He told you what he expected, and there was nothing in between. You either did it, you did it his way, or you were out the door. And, you know, I guess I did it because he kept me on.
Ladies and gentlemen, I appreciate this honor, and I don't know how long I'll be physically able and mentally able to continue, but I'll try real hard to go for a long time. And I want to say I did a little figuring before this program, and I figured out that more than 200 million people have watched this program, this wrestling program, over the span of 20 years, and we promoted 1,040 Wrestling at the Chase. Thank you very much.
And he was one guy that never, never missed telling you what a good job you did when the bout was over.
Sam was Mr. Wrestling in his time. He made the sport, and I don't think there's too many people that would say elsewise.
Sam was one of the few promoters that was respected by everybody across the board.
Sam was an honest man. Sam was the greatest guy to work for. And I never seen Sam, I guess he's got, sometimes he got hollered under the collar, but he would do it with that little smile, like, I don't think you ought to do it that way, Mickey, or Larry, I think you ought to talk more about this. Sam, to me, he always called me, I always called him my godfather, because he really took care of me.
I think the most important legacy that he left is his honesty. In fact, someone had given me an article after he died that someone had written that was on the internet, and he talked about the one thing my father was the honest wrestling promoter.
It's wonderful to be able to go out when you say you had a sellout. I had many a crowd of 1,900 and 2,000 people. St. Louis has been good to me, and the only reason I was successful is because of the millions of fans in St. Louis and around the world that came to the matches. I've been successful because I had the finest wrestlers that anybody could procure for this area, for St. Louis, and I owe it all to you. A promoter cannot do well unless he gets the people in the building or if he gets the wrestlers. I know you want to see the next two matches. I'm going to make this short. Thank you, St. Louis.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sam Muchnick.
Sam Muchnick had been promoting wrestling in St. Louis since 1945, but it was not until he partnered with Harold Copler and his new television station, KPLR, that the idea for wrestling at the Chase began to blossom.
KPLR was the fourth independent to sign on in the United States. Television was different at the time. We couldn't go out and buy syndicated shows. We had to rely on local creativity to come up with a programming schedule that you could put on the air for 18 hours a day. So we did a lot of unusual things. If I recall the story, was my father and Sam were on an airplane together, and they got into a discussion about wrestling and then the fact that it might be a very interesting event. My dad was another genius as far as entertainment was concerned. He had a sense that, this could work as an event. And both him and Sam pioneered something very new and very original.
It was a risk that Harold Copler had to take. It was a risk that Sam Muchnick had to take. And to combine that with the coverage, and that's why they had a hit.
Another great thing that, is hard to understand in today's world. I don't think there ever was a formal contract between my father and Sam. It was written down on a piece of paper, a doily, that they had on the airplane. There was no formal contract. They shook hands and they honored that.
Harold was he was getting it going and pretty much fighting for his life. And when they came up with this idea, it was word of mouth. And then they found out that, hey, the cameramen are just as good as the other guys, if not better. And this guy, and it was not a, KPLR was not a station that was being run with Polaroid cameras. These were thorough professionals, and we were getting the job done. And we had, and I say this with some degree of humility, we had a hit show on our hands.
Wrestling virtually dominated our Sunday mornings. The ratings matched, believe it or not, NFL football.
I thought that Wrestling at the Chase showed that the KPLR was here to stay.
Obviously, KPLR was here to stay for over 40 years now. All of the pieces were falling into place. A great promoter, a broadcaster who wanted original local programming. The big question was where to do the show. Fortunately, Harold Copler owned the Chase Hotel and the beautiful Khorassan Room. Wrestling from the Khorassan Room. It set a standard unmatched anywhere in the wrestling world.
First of all, the fact that you were in the Khorassan Room immediately put you a cut above any other place in the entire country. I mean, because we would have wrestlers coming from No Name Nebraska in a high school gym on bleachers or whatever, putting on a show, or maybe it would be outdoors at a drive-in theater. Now all of a sudden, here they come in to the Chase Hotel, the premier hotel in St. Louis.
Now, let's go to ringside and Joe Garagiola.
Hi, everybody, and welcome once again to Wrestling at the Chase. Yes, sir, wall to wall, and boy, tonight we're going to have them all over this place.
Oh, it was a wonderful experience to walk into a civilized place, some of the down-the-road little tank towns, that we wrestled, the ring is in bad shape, and they maybe have a 10-watt bulb over the ring or something like that, and of course that room was... That was the elite, and that was the hallmark for the entire world.
And look at here. And the crowd loves it.
The Khorassan Room was just a fantastic place to be. I mean, everybody was just sitting at tables, relaxing.
I have to say this, Wrestling at the Chase had a great impact on all the fans, because they had a great building to come see it in.
The referee is Joe Schoenberg. This match is one fall with a 15-minute time limit.
Gentlemen,
you're both familiar with the rules of the Missouri State Athletic Commission. Do either of you have any questions? Shake hands now and come out wrestling at the bell.
Joe Schoenberger is a referee.
And they've seen great wrestlers come there and wrestle. They didn't have a place where it was bad, but it was a high-class building. And that's what made wrestling so great at the Chase.
I mean, the Chase Hotel, when I was growing up, we used to drive by here and wish that we would win a contest or have enough money to go into the Chase Hotel.
Oh, that was wall-to-wall wrestling. I mean, that was the tops. That was your Waldorf Astoria. I mean, that was great. And here these guys coming in from, a smelly dressing room and an auditorium and a coliseum, and now they got class. They're serving food. They got tablecloths on a table, and they're up there beating each other up.
You're thinking about walking out into just an ordinary hall to wrestle, and you're walking out into fine dining, people in tuxedos and evening gowns and all sitting around the ring, and you're wondering, what in God's name am I doing here?
And I thought, what a concept. This is so different than, I mean, wrestling and the Khorassan Room, but I tell you, it turned out to be an event.
Walking into a room that seated probably 800-900 people, all dressed in evening attire, sitting there sipping champagne. If that doesn't take you back to the Roman gladiator days.
Where else but the Khorassan Room? It was perfect. It was gorgeous. It was unique. Up next, why wrestling at the Chase could only have happened in St. Louis, and all of the great action you never forgot. I'll revisit it with you.
Now you can use this as a pin too, though, really, right?
Right. Well, if I want to use it as a pin, I'll grab you from here.
Yeah.
And I'll just roll you straight back like.
Yes.
Ask him.
Do you give up?
I gave up a long time ago.
We still got time.
Oh.
Larry, I've been in St. Louis an awful long time. I'm going to make a forecast. Sam Matysik is the most fair promoter I guess I've ever met in my life. The greatest promoter that in the United States, no doubt about that. I will state this. Sam Matysik, if you are listening to me, you arrange a title match for David Von Erich, and I say that you'll have a new world heavyweight champion.
What would wrestling at the Chase be without wrestling? Get ready. Hang on. Here we go.
Three minutes left.
For the second time in this fabulous battle, it's David Von Erich with the Iron Claw and Harley Race. Race trying to get away, looking for those ropes again. David kicks the hands off the rope. David kicking the hands off the rope. He has Race in the middle. There's plenty of time left, still over 2 minutes remaining. I don't care how tough Race is, I don't think even he can hang on under the stress of the Iron Claw that long. Race grabbing the referee, and Race! Oh, Race slamming the referee, Charles Vanader, into David Von Erich. Vanader cracked his head into the jaw of Von Erich. Von Erich pitched through the ropes and out of the ring by Race. The referee is down and injured. Race going outside the ring after David Von Erich. David stunned after hitting head first with the referee. He's going for a suplex outside the ring on the concrete floor. Oh, Race! With a suplex on David Von Erich. Outside the ring of David's been hurt. His legs quivering. He's been hurt. The referee calling for the bell. I'm sure he's going to disqualify Race for slamming him into Von Erich. But that doesn't no way justify what Race just did to David Von Erich. Race going up on the top rope. Race slapping at Vanader. David Von Erich has been injured. Down on the floor. Badly hurt. He's holding his shoulder. Here comes Kerry Von Erich! Von Erich pushes Race into the ring! Kerry Von Erich jumping Race!
That's Valentine, a close-up of Valentine. That took some courage. That top shot that you see right now, that's Tim Moritsugu. Ted Wallman's on our floor camera. Wayne Anderson is our switcher. Andy Anderson, our video man. Mike Whalen's our floor man. Fred Rockman is our director. And Roy May is our producer. Mel Felder is our audio man.
5 minutes have gone by. There are 10 minutes left.
Bill Frazier with the headlock on Johnny Valentine. Ought to be some kind of a television show for Valentine, you know, like Johnny Dollar or something. Yours truly, Johnny Valentine. Or I was a teenage pizza or something. Wake up, Roy. Bill Frazier and Johnny Valentine. John hasn't used that baking soda Arm & Hammer that he likes to use. Boy, he drives him right into the ground. The natives are counting the beads. Look like a Valentine fan. Joe Schoenberger's our referee, and he's bouncing around pretty good. I hope you can hear that one lady. Her voice seems to just pierce right on through. Oh, boy.
Koniski and Von Erich double-team the Bulldog briefly. Tag made to Koniski. And Koniski's after Brown. Koniski with a knee to the neck. Another knee by Gene Koniski, the former world champion. Flying mare by Koniski, and then he uses Brown's face like a doorstep. Koniski goes for the pin. Brown throws him off. Murdoch stays in to kick Koniski in the head. Kevin's after Murdoch. Brown working on the throat of Koniski, drops Koniski. Brown slams Koniski's head into the top buckle, and Brown tags Murdoch. Koniski misses with that punch to the stomach, and then Murdoch drops Koniski with a series of kicks. Koniski whipped to the ropes by Dick Murdoch, and Murdoch catches Koniski with an elbow underneath the chin. Brown yells, "This is it." No, not yet. Koniski's made of stern stuff. Koniski trying to get to Kevin Von Erich, makes the tag. Kevin with a knee lift to the stomach. Koniski holding Murdoch on those ropes for Kevin Von Erich.
3 minutes left, 3 minutes.
3 minutes left. Murdoch flipped up and over by Kevin Von Erich. Drop kick by Kevin, knocks Brown over the top rope. Drop kick by Kevin, floors Murdoch. Another drop kick. Murdoch manages to keep his feet. Kevin charging into Murdoch with tackles, but then Murdoch catches Von Erich and slams his head into the top buckle. Murdoch covering Kevin. The referee making a count of three. Koniski and Brown battling over here. Was there a pin made? Yeah. Wendy Richter, for all her wildness, she uses her head. She got those knees up and caught Jill Fontaine right in the stomach. Fontaine hurled to the ropes and dropped by Wendy Richter with a forearm smash. Another smash drops Jill Fontaine. That Richter is so big and tough, she can take the punishment. She still comes back. It's like she hasn't taken a lump at all.
10 minutes have passed, 10 minutes left.
And I gotta tell you something about Wendy Richter. She's got some bruises on her thighs. I can see a weld on her rib. She's taken some beating in this match, but she's still able to come back, storm back. She just won't quit. Grable puts Fontaine down after gouging the eyes. Fontaine dropped.
Most of the blows actually by Grable and Richter are forearm smash, and that makes them legal punches. Grable right on top of Summers. Flying, look at Summers stop that. A catapult catching herself, a cartwheel and a drop kick, a second drop kick puts Joyce Grable down. A third drop kick misses. Oh, Grable suckered her in. She lured her in, and Summers tried that drop kick, and it missed because Grable stepped back. Grable, using her head, got out of the way. Richter. A backflip. They catch Summers in the air. Oh, and Summers thrown down heavily on her neck and shoulders. Richter then catches.
Boy, I got excited, didn't I? I had more hair, too. We'll be back with more matches from Wrestling at the Chase.
What can I tell you? You know it yourself. Every one of these freeloaders sitting out here, it doesn't matter who I'm wrestling, they always root for the other person, right? This town has been very, very impartial to Dick Murdoch.
When you talk about St. Louis, there are so many great things you can refer to. But in wrestling, St. Louis is the capital. Every wrestler wanted to come to St. Louis, and getting a main event in St. Louis, being on Wrestling at the Chase, could make a huge difference in any wrestler's career.
St. Louis was like the wrestling capital of the United States for certain, and the world, because there was not a city anywhere in the world that had access to that kind of talent every time it ran.
Everybody, all the wrestlers around the world wanted to be booked in St. Louis. That was their dream. I've got to wrestle in St. I really want to wrestle in St. Louis.
Everybody that I felt like came here, you know, it developed that aura, that thing, you know, like St. Louis. You know, it was almost like it was considered one of the meccas of wrestling in that time. And when you came to St. Louis, you know, you were always going to put your best foot forward. You're going to do the absolute best job you could.
St. Louis had all the right people. All the time. It was a magical city, and Sam kind of kept it that way.
You know, it seems that every time a young man's had a chance, the likes of Ted DiBiase, Ric Flair, St. Louis has been the town. St. Louis has been the town all the time that's made the great champions.
St. Louis was one of those few places where wrestling was more respected for what it really is. You know, I don't know why. Maybe it's Sam, you know, maybe because of Sam's love and the heart and the way he presented the business to the people here in St. Louis.
The fact that St. Louis was a catalyst for wrestling, and St. Louis fans, believe it or not, helped make this whole phenomena of wrestling happen.
There were so many great fans that we had. You know, they line up at 10 o'clock in the morning to let them in for the 12 o'clock taping. And they'd be out there lined up, and you say, well, you're crazy, you know. But that's the kind of fans that we had here in St. Louis. They were just great fans.
If you wrestled at the Chase Hotel or wrestled at Kiel Auditorium in St. Louis, that to wrestling is what it is if the boxers fight in Madison Square Garden. Wrestling is it as far as St. Louis goes. It's one of the finest wrestling cities in the country, in fact, the world. The fans here, Larry, are outstanding. As much as I don't care too much for them, they are.
You.
Well, they always boo me, and I don't care. But I still like the fans in St. Louis.
St. Louis was unique. St. Louis was a city that was a territory. It was an entity of all its own. And because all of the big names from all of those other territories would come to St. Louis. And, I mean, St. Louis would get the cream of the crop from the entire country.
In the tradition of St. Louis, I'm going back to Sam Mushnick, the greatest promoter of all time. I'm going to Ed Strangler Lewis, Luthez, Pat O'Connor, Kaniski, the Funks, the Friscoes, Harley Race, and now, woo!
Ric Flair.
Wow. Ric Flair.
It was born here, it was bred here, is once again something you don't hear a lot about. But if this town had never accepted wrestling the way they accepted it, it might never have been the national success it's been in today's world.
As I traveled around, people said, did you wrestle in St. Louis? I said, yes. And said, well, I wish I could. You know, that kind of thing. And it had a great image. And We would all like to perpetuate that, or try to regain it, is what I should say.
When you mention the name St. Louis in context as in wrestling, whether it's here or in Tokyo, Japan, it is the city in the world still today that just mentioning the name when you're talking in wrestling is the wrestling city of the world.
Wrestling at the Chase ended in 1984, but certainly is not forgotten. When we return, a very special moment involving my partner Mickey Garagiola with Harley Race and Ted DiBiase.
Get into the ring quickly after a tag. This is a complicated match, folks.
I gotta tell you.
Look at that! Joyce Crable slaps Bulldog Brown and Brown there for Crable. Joyce Crable jumped into the ring and slapped Brown right across the mouth. This crowd loves it.
Nobody in the history of St. Louis wrestling has stepped in the ring with more world champions and quality opponents than I have. I've beaten Terry Funk. You saw it. I beat Pat O'Connor. You saw it. I beat Jack Briscoe. I beat every world champion I've been in the ring with. Then you tried to throw DiBiase in with me, Rookie of the Year.
When Ted DiBiase tangled with world champion Harley Race in a tag team battle, everybody knew it'd be a great match, but nobody could have guessed the outcome. I'll let my sidekick for 100 years, Mickey Garagiola, tell this story.
I'll never forget Larry, Ted DiBiase and Harley Race. They are in the ring and they're wrestling and they are pulling every stop out of the bag.
Race strangling DiBiase from outside the ring. Brown grabs DiBiase by the hair and throws DiBiase through the ropes and out of the ring. Harley Race going outside after him. Arndorf comes over and keeps Race from getting a DiBiase. Now Race grabs DiBiase. He tries the pile driver on the concrete floor. He's trying to go. Look at DiBiase! DiBiase with a back body drop, slamming Race into the concrete floor. Race and DiBiase stand toe-to-toe. The brilliant young star, Ted DiBiase, against the seasoned and experienced world champion, Harley Race. Race knocked backwards by DiBiase, who tags Arndorf. And here comes Ted DiBiase. He's after Brown. Brown whipped across the ring and into the corner. Brown catapulted out and up and over by DiBiase. Brown pulls into DiBiase, tags Harley Race. Here comes Race. DiBiase doesn't know it, and Race is behind him. Race was behind DiBiase. DiBiase didn't know he was into the ring. Race going for the suplex. This could be... Oh, what a move by DiBiase! Back body drop, a giant suplex, a bridge. DiBiase pins the champion. Ted DiBiase has pinned the world heavyweight champion. DiBiase with a back suplex has pinned Harley Race. Race went for his suplex. DiBiase with a brilliant move. Slipped behind Race and with a back suplex, Ted DiBiase pins the world champion Harley Race. Has he made it to stardom? Has Ted DiBiase stepped over that line today?
And now it comes time, I guess, and Ted DiBiase pins Harley Race.
I lost the fall, and Mickey says, and we have a new world heavyweight champion.
I was so worked up in the match, I thought it was the greatest match I ever saw. Man, I ran, jumped in the ring, I said, in 29 minutes and 14 seconds, the new world's heavyweight wrestling champion, Ted DiBiase. Race is laying on a canvas, and he's going, no, no, no. And I'm saying to myself, what do you mean? To my son, no, no, he beat you.
Well, I guess no one bothered to tell Mickey that you couldn't lose the title in a tag team, but.
Sam Matysik, I don't know what he was doing in the back room, in the control room. He's going crazy. So when he's saying, no, 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 I figured I better get out of here because Race might get up and let me have it. So I got out and I listened to you say, and this was one of the outstanding matches of wrestling at the Chase. And Mickey got so worked up on that that he forgot that this was not a championship match. I said, oh, Mick, you goof.
And I want to thank Mickey right now for declaring me the world champion. Yeah, I will never, ever forget that. That was so funny. And that was the springboard. It was that tag team match on the television show that, more than anything else, set up that main event.
But it turned out all right because I didn't know that was a promo for the next big bout at the Keel.
Sold out.
Sold out.
it made for one hell of an exciting hour of TV.
Harley, I couldn't have said it better myself. Coming up, more action from Wrestling at the Chase.
I'm going to tell you this, DiBiase. I'm the owner of this. I possess this Missouri State title. You want it. You try to cripple me to get it. But I'm going to tell you something right now, DiBiase. You have your fan club in the back here, and I want a little more respect here when I come to St. Louis.
The crowd yelling, "We want Ted."
See, I can't get any respect out of DiBiase, and I can get even less out of these geeks down here.
Now, we'll do it kind of like in slow motion. Now, you're behind me, we'll say. Now, what
That's
would
right.
you do? All right.
See where my right foot is?
Yes.
My left is right behind you, so all I do is this.
Oh! and now I can't get up. Huh?
No, Joe, you can't get up. This is my match winner.
How can anybody forget these classic moments from Wrestling at the Chase?
Rick, you've got a challenge up there. I think it's either put up or shut up. You want to get in there and maybe you'll...
Like I said before, out of the goodness of my heart, this time with a great deal of pleasure will I get in there.
Ric Flair, okay, we'll see some basic fundamental wrestling. Let's put it down to the basics. Let's put it down amateur style. Flair shakes hands with Reed. We'll see who decides they want to go in a down position. They want to start head-to-head. Reed has apparently said that he will. Well, will he? I don't know. They're debating who's going to go down position first. Flair says he'll give the advantage to Reed. Flair getting down. We saw, well, Flair escaped before from Andrews and Curtis Dean. Reed getting behind Flair. Now Flair complaining about where that hand is positioned legally. The referee checking it. Loran says wrestle. Flair sits out. Reed riding him. Flair sitting out, tried to switch. Flair trying to get away. Reed riding him. Flair rolls and ends up in the ropes. Well, Reed rode him. And Flair got away nowhere. Ric Flair, perhaps his ego has taken a bit of a jolt. Flair tells the referee, "He grabbed my sweatpants." Lee Warren says, "No, I was watching carefully." "You get down," says Ric Flair to Butch Reed. Reed getting down. And Ric Flair will be in the up position. "Come on," says Reed. "Let's get to it." Flair getting down. They wrestle. Reed scooting around. Sits out. Flair trying to hang on. And he loses him. And Reed would have credit for an escape there. Ric Flair not too happy about what's happening here. "Can you do that one more time?" Flair says. "Want to try again?" "Fine with me, Rick. You're the guy in the ring. If you're the guy getting embarrassed if he gets away, it's fine with me." He tells Reed to get down again, hands and knees. "Me down," says Reed. "Is that what you want?" "Okay, fine." Butch Reed, I think, figures he's already proven a point. Flair debating which side he wants to start from. Go ahead. Oh, Flair with a kick in the ribs. And Flair grabs Curtis Dean and fires Dean right over the top rope. Andrews tries to intervene. Ric Flair, that ego, took a knock. There's a chop to Reed. Reed whipped to the rope by Flair. He misses an elbow. Reed comes flying off. Oh, Flair David Von Erich tosses Murdoch to the ropes. Flying tackle flattens David Von Erich.
10 minutes have expired. 10 minutes left.
David Von Erich with the claw on Murdoch. Roski charging into the ring. And he's after David Von Erich. David still hanging on with the claw. Now Roski with the claw. Roski with the claw on Von Erich. The Von Erich's own weapon being used against them. Von Roski with the claw on David Von Erich. Roski digging in. David Von Erich sagging, starting to lose consciousness as Roski uses the Von Erich's own weapon against them. David, back on his feet, trying to keep his consciousness, trying to keep his head up. He has the claw on Roski. Both men with claws. Roski with the claw on Von Erich. Von Erich with the claw on Roski. They end up in the ropes. If they can get either man to release the claw, finally, both claws broken. The claw against the claw. Boy, you saw it graphically right there. Roski and David Von Erich. Knee lift by DiBiase flattens Roski. Body slam by DiBiase. Here comes Murdoch. He breaks up a potential pin. And DiBiase is angrily after Murdoch. DiBiase and Murdoch. DiBiase knocking Murdoch down to the apron. Roski and David Von Erich battling in the middle of the ring. Murdoch pulls DiBiase outside. Murdoch slamming him into the table. Down goes Ted DiBiase. Murdoch slamming him into the announcer's table. Von Roski with a figure four arm lock on David Von Erich. There's the claw. There's the claw by Von Erich on Roski. The claw by Von Erich on Roski. Roski squirming towards the rope. Murdoch's up on the top rope. Murdoch's on the top rope, and there's DiBiase after Murdoch. DiBiase knocks Murdoch off the top rope. Roski still clawing David Von Erich's claw. There goes Murdoch up on the ropes again. He leaps off the rope. He's caught in the stomach claw. Von Erich has a claw on either man. He had the iron claw on Roski and the stomach claw on Murdoch before Murdoch broke it up by gouging the eye of Von Erich. DiBiase struggling to the apron. Brody on top of him again.
Not giving him a chance to rest, not giving him a chance to move. He's staying on him all the time, just like a lion for the kill.
Like a human dynamo.
That's right.
Brody seems to have endless stamina, and DiBiase has to turn it around. He has to get it going here, Rock. If he takes much more.
Right, he's going to have to do something to do it fast.
McGuire trying to keep Brody back. DiBiase slams that shoulder into Brody's stomach. Brody tries to get some wind. Look at DiBiase. Goes up over the ropes. Grabs Brody's head. Goes behind him. Pulls him back into the cradle. This could be it. Count of two. Brody, too strong. Too strong, Rocky. Looks like Shades of the Sunset flipped there for a second. Now DiBiase pounds on the head of Brody. Brody hurled to the ropes. Drop kick. Shades of your drop kick again. Flying elbow drop. DiBiase goes for the pin. Two. Can't keep him down. DiBiase showing us something here, Rocky.
That's right, the kid sure is. You know, he's trying, and he's trying hard, and he's got one thing in mind, to win.
Going for the figure four leg lock, but Brody grabbed DiBiase's hair and pulled him away. Brody, a bit gimpy right now. Of course, Ted goes to the spinning toe hold in before he goes to that figure four. Again, Brody pulled the hair. Brody crawling for the ropes, and DiBiase is after that knee, after that leg. Spinning toe hold. Goes for the figure four. Brody kicks DiBiase clear over the top rope into the concrete floor. Was not a deliberate move, so no disqualification. Look at Brody. He's getting a little wilder now. He's out after DiBiase. He took a tremendous fall over the top rope. It's turning into a Donnybrook, Rocky.
That's exactly what it is there.
Brody slams DiBiase. No, DiBiase caught himself. DiBiase caught himself and didn't take the ring post. Now Brody slammed into the table.
When we return, one final look back at Wrestling at the Chase.
The Bruiser pounding on Harley Race. The Bruiser trying to get off that gold belt. Race gets it. The Bruiser, the belt dropped to the floor. Race going for the pile driver. Race for the Bruiser reverses it. The Bruiser grabs the gold belt. The Bruiser has Race's belt, stands on Race, and raises the gold belt in triumph. Dick the Bruiser.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Well, I'm really very pleased to be back to the seat of wrestling culture, and our mutual friend Sam Muchnick, of course, is largely responsible for that. But like Sam, like myself, and many others that have devoted their lives to wrestling, we were doing what we enjoyed doing. And sometimes if you continue to do that throughout your lifetime, you begin to learn something about it. You know, that's the way it goes.
What those thousands of fans tuning in every weekend to Wrestling at the Chase did not realize was they were helping us, those of us behind the scenes in the promotion, create some magical personal moments.
And I have a lot of people today. Hey, I remember you on ring Wrestling at the Chase. I have that right now. You can go down, I go to a ball game or something like that, and somebody will remember, I remember you. That's a celebrity part, I guess you would say. And everybody's got a little Hammond, and I got one. I got a big one.
It's a crazy, haphazard life. And if you learn to relax with it and get some joy out of it, it's a winner.
All of a sudden, you get on TV, and this was in a small country town in New Haven. And, you know, I was a big thing there all of a sudden. You know, here's the referee, referee Lee Warren. And it really helped out on that part.
But still today, it's there every time we go out. We can leave here now and drive up the street here, and I'll guarantee you, if we walk into any one of those businesses, before we walk out, somebody's going to ask me about Wrestling at the Chase.
I always loved coming here. Always loved coming here because I always knew that I was going to be not only liked and loved by the fans, because I certainly was, but I was going to be respected.
I tell you, it was a great evening out to be at Wrestling at the Chase.
To Ruthie, to Juanita, to Diane, to Kathy, to Mr. Barris, to Mr. Foster, to Mel, to Ed, to all the thousands of you fans who shared this excitement with the Bruiser, with Brody, with the Von Erichs, with Funk, with Murdoch. Wow, it was fun, wasn't it? Thanks for watching. See you soon.
So there it is, a package of thrilling events and outstanding stars. That's what helps to make Wrestling at the Chase so popular in the greater St. Louis area. But there is one other item that should be mentioned, and that is you. You, the people who support wrestling. Without you, well, we don't count. So thank you very much. This has been Larry Matysik, and don't forget, next weekend, new action resumes, same time, same place here on KPLR.